Internet, and welcome to another episode of That's All I Have to Say About That, Africa Wednesday. As always, I'm your host, Stephen Mackey. Today we're talking about South Sudan, a country in which 99.8% of their exports are oil, making it very weird that they joined the Paris Climate Agreement. Come on, guys, if there's anyone who I wouldn't blame for not signing on to the climate agreement, it would be you. Essentially, your entire export economy is based on oil sales, which, last time I checked, is the exact opposite of everything the climate agreement stands for. So, why are we talking about Sudan today? Well, it's because they're suffering from a very interesting problem right now.
We start in South Sudan, which is experiencing hyperinflation following the ongoing conflict.
Turns out that Sudan is experiencing more inflation than Donald Trump's ego after becoming president, reaching rates of 661%, which means that it suddenly became a major issue whether your boss paid you on a monthly or bi-weekly basis. Imagine that, making $1,000 a month and then just having that value drop to $166 over the course of 1 month. As an economics fan, all I have to say is, wow, what a great time to start taking out massive loans. So that month later, you can say to your bank, hey, you remember when you lent me $100 worth of our currency last month? Yeah, here's a penny. I picked up this topic specifically because I read a headline that I didn't fully understand and surprised me. To fight hyperinflation, South Sudan decides to tax aid workers. Wow, what a specific group. Although in South Sudan, aid workers might actually be the 1%. And if you're a place like South Sudan, you definitely don't need additional incentives for aid workers to not want to come there. Besides the somewhat consistent killing of aid workers, you also have general diseasiness of the area. First, what causes inflation? Well, in this case, it was a combination of money printing and economic collapse. It all started back in 2011 when South Sudan got their independence. But come on, if you're going to declare your independence from a country, don't use the direction you are from that entity and then that entity's name. Didn't work for North Korea, West Virginia, or either of the Dakotas too well. It's like breaking up with someone and then saying, call me as you leave. Anyways, a small oil-rich country that has just been created.
A nation is born. The symbol of sovereignty and identity flies for the first time. The scene in South Sudan is nothing less than electric.
And that nation wasn't about to start making financially responsible decisions when there was so much of that sweet, sweet oil that made the West melt in the palm of their hand. $100 a barrel? Yeah, alright, I'm gonna focus my investment on agricultural development. Well, then the government shut down, and not in the American style, well, it's still all kinda working, but just enough to make everything noticeably inconvenient. I'm talking shut down, shut down. This was followed by...
The world's youngest nation feared to be on the brink of collapse. After more than a week of fighting, the army says it is now getting ready to move in and retake two key cities.
Yeah, the army did get to those cities, and fighting ensued for another 5 years, continuing to today. Maybe we'll end up with a Southwest Sudan and a Southeast Sudan. Because war is war and represents the exact opposite of development, South Sudan's oil production was halved, not to mention that the actual price of oil went down by half in the same period. So basically, not good. Because of its single industry, the government, or what was left of it, needed to think fast. They could either increase their GDP or cut government spending. Borrowing money through bond sales was off the table because a small warring country in Africa seems to be about as good an investment as buying a new Lamborghini from a dealership that has mud and no paved road in sight. That said, South Sudan came up with a unique solution: print more money. Now this really helps South Sudan pay its bills for a few days. You want some money? Hey, here's some money. They were living large as they were before the Civil War. But then, inflation struck. Because apparently, make it rain is an equally good monetary strategy for rappers as it is the government. This brings us back to today, where a few solutions to problems are being discussed. First, we have a bailout, which is going to solve the development problems, but is about as good a solution for the massive inflation problem as shooting yourself in the foot because you found out you don't have health insurance. Combating inflation is simple. Get money out of the economy. So this might be an answer to why a government would want to up their taxes levied on foreign aid workers. How much are foreign aid workers being charged again? Well, it was a change from $100 per person to $10,000 per person. Wow, that's actually a more inflated price than encountered in South Sudan. Now this is an interesting strategy because not only do social workers tend not to be deterred by prices as much as other professions, but also the government is gaining a more stable currency. They also don't seem to be a shortage of aid workers in South Sudan either, although at least 22 were killed last year. Honestly, and I'm probably never going to say this again, but South Sudan, you guys have too much money. Sounds like a good problem, but no. The solution is to find a way to take it away. Now, another standard way of government taking away money in South Sudan is an unofficial invasion of a town, but there's a more subtle way that some people are recommending. Domestically issue bonds. A bond is basically an IOU from the government, but in order to owe someone money, you have to get it from them, hence removing some of the cash from the country. Now, this is not the perfect solution for many reasons. First, it increases government debt, hence the IOU structure. Now, I've heard African debt might be a problem, so adding more debt might be like fixing inflation by spending more money. Although, in this case, you would have already have the money to pay down the debt. Second, it would not be a good deal at all for the government, considering they would have to add favorable terms to the deals. It's no stretch of the imagination to picture a world in which South Sudan no longer exists, and it's pretty hard to collect money from an entity that has ceased to exist. Just ask Enron investors. Recently, though, we have seen
joy on the streets of Sudan after the U.S. State Department announced it was lifting 20-year-old economic and trade sanctions.
And we have seen a lessening of inflation in South Sudan, so maybe there might be a solution to Sudan's problems that doesn't include a 10,000% increase in the amount aid workers who are risking their lives to be there have to pay. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube! I hope you enjoyed this video. For more episodes of Africa Wednesday, click here. And if you're really a fan, you can join our Facebook group. It's just a party over there. Remember to like and subscribe.